Melissa Langer, and I'll be chairing this session on security, states, and the subjects. So we're going to have three presentations from now till 10 o'clock, and then have discussions for about 45 minutes. So the first presentation, it's by Diaco Radigras and Jets.
Yevre Kotas.
Kotaski.
It's always a problem.
And their presentation is entitled Militarem Odedem, Embedded Security and Governmentality in Rio de Janeiro and Lima. Just a brief summary of the presenters as written in the program. Jess Godasaki is an associate professor at the Department of Politics and Legal Doctrine at the University of Lodz, Poland, and a researcher at the Institute of Peruvian Studies in Peru. And Dr. Diaco Radigras is an associate professor at the Institute for Strategic Studies of the Fluminense National University, Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. His main interest includes history and analysis of trafficking, drug policies, and the war on drugs in the Americas, and militarization of public security, theorization on the illegal transactional flows, arms trafficking, human trafficking, etc. Welcome.
Thank you,
Chris, and your fellow presenters.
Thank you. Thank you, folks. Good morning. First of all, I'd like to thank Carl and Gareth for this kind invitation, and also all the folks from SWAP's team for their efficiency and kindness. It's been a pleasure and very interesting colloquium. And before we begin, I would like to present a disclaimer here. Firstly, for the sake of the presentation, and due to the limitations of time, we decided, Yevre and I, to focus on the conceptual lines of our research and on some aspects of the militarization of townships in Rio. So we are leaving the discussion on Villa El Salvador in Lima, the township in Lima, for the final version of our paper. Okay, it's the first thing. Secondly, I will present here, we're going to present here a short video. It's a footage from the Brazilian Marines. And this is a special video. I'm going to tell you about the story, quickly about the story about this video. It was taped in 2015 during the occupation by the Marines of the Maré township nearby the International Airport in Rio de Janeiro. I would like you to suggest to pay attention to two things. The first one is you're gonna see a Marine soldier in the first plan with his cell phone. In his cell phone, he's checking for a list of wanted people. They find one of them, and they catch him, in fact. The second part is the military trying to extract him from the favela, and some members of his gang trying to save him. Okay? It's a 2-minute video. I cannot reveal the source for matters of security, his security and mine, my safety as well. It's the first time we play this video publicly, okay? And then we present our presentation properly. Please, Yedri. Well, since it is a footage from the Marines, it makes an interesting connection with the movie we saw the first day, because it's an official recording. Yeah. So this happened. Please, the other our presentation. We are trying to present here some conceptual notes. What we are calling a military ordinance. Our hypothesis, please. Our hypothesis is that the townships or slums in Rio and Lima are a compound of territory and population subjected to a colonial type form of government. We are calling here military ordinance, trying to explain it later. We claim that these territories and populations have been ruled and managed in an analog fashion to the colonies as analyzed by Achille Mbembe in Necropolitics. And quoting Mbembe, colonies might be ruled over in absolute lawlessness stems from the racial denial of any common bond between the conqueror and the native. In the eyes of the conqueror, savage life is just another form of animal life. Continuing with Mbembe, the colonies are inhabited by savages. They do not establish a distinction between combatants and non-combatants, or again, between an enemy and a criminal. By saying that, we challenge the widespread notion that the current target represented by the criminal, or the gang member, or even the drug dealer, are mere presentifications of the former internal enemy from the Cold War. They are vast literature on this theme. We call here Santo, Catechiano, Madrasso, etc. And myself, I used to think like that. I don't think like that anymore. I changed my mind about it. Yeah. Instead of being the eternal enemy, the black, young, and poor townships' inhabitants are targeted as savages, inhumans or non-humans, since the criminals are understood as individuals who have denied the social contract. Hence, they live in a natural state, denying the social contract. They are outside the civilized world. Townships, slums are, because of that, the outside encrusted in the inside, a cluster of savagery within civilization. And we use here this notion by Rob Walker, from Inside Outside, taken from the international relations discussion, for a internal or a domestic politics discussion. So the police and the military violence toward that population is not a Clausewitzian war, since the enemy is some country's citizen. The township inhabitant is not a citizen. Ergo, he or she is not an enemy, but a person that subdued to a bare life, as would say Agamben. However, this situation is not merely in a state of exception, as would say Agamben, but an ordinary order, since democracies, our democracies, are not underdeveloped polyarchies, but violent pluralistic democracies, as put by Arias and Goldstein in a very provoking text from 2010. Townships, slums, live under a special governmentality we are calling Militarin Ordinem. Militarin Ordinem is a reference to a late Roman Republic legal status, which established an hybrid military rule over recent conquered barbarian land by the Romans. It was a system in which there was a very special kind of combination between Roman martial law, alliance with subjected warlords, alliance with subjected civilian authorities, such as religious leaders and economic barons, for example. We claim that in Rio, for example, in real Islams, it is possible to find a similar kind of hybrid government, combining military police pacification forces, armed forces pacification missions, gangs and militias alliances, local civilian leaderships connections, etc. We have now some photos to show the connection or the relationship between the informal city, the slums or townships, and the formal city in Rio, to show this connection and the proximity between those areas. The first photo displays the Rocinha township. This is the biggest favela in Brazil. It's in Brazil and in Rio, of course. It has around 1 million inhabitants. It's more or less the size of Johannesburg. Just the favela Rocinha. And across the avenue, you have this São Conrado neighborhood. This is an upper class neighborhood. A very fancy neighborhood. The second photo shows another slum, Dona Marta, is an older slum. The first one that received a pacification force in 2008. This photo is from the Botafogo neighborhood. It's a very traditional middle class neighborhood in Rio. The following is nowadays the world-known favela do Alemão or Alemão township, and you can see on the horizon the Tijuca neighborhood also a very non-middle class neighborhood. Now some photos from the military intervention in Rio de Janeiro State that took place last year. You can see very sympathetic figures. Just more Marines, military from the Navy, Marines, military. Refer to the next one, please. Again, military, it was during the occupation of Rocinha Township. Another one. This, again, over the avenue, there is this little bridge for pedestrians. You see three women there, two protecting themselves from shooting, and one that was shot during the occupation. Those guys belong to the military police, to the special battalion called BOP. It's a special battalion from the military police in Rio, and the armored vehicle called the Big Skull that looks like it's similar to the vehicles you have here in South Africa right now and during the apartheid regime. No, it's from the military police, it's not from the military armed forces. And this is properly the Marines and a military vehicle of troops transportation trying to occupy a part or the lower part of favela da Rocinha, the Rocinha township. Well, in sum, this concept, this proposition of this concept of military ordinance try to address a framework for analysis of this population ruled by a combination of draconian conductoral rules enforced by the military police, by local gangs, by militias, with a strict discipline enforced by local churches, especially neo-Pentecostal churches, a combination of violence enforced by a variety of forces, the same forces that occupy and rule these areas, the military police, local gangs, militias, death squads, etc. So we're trying to address here in sum that we have a kind of colonial rule inside the city, the informal city, ruled and managed by a sort of a plethora of groups, a plethora of forces, a plethora of violent agents from the state and non-state in various types of connections and hybridity in symbiotic connections. And this is, in our opinion, in Yedri's, in mine, could be analyzed in a more interesting way using post-colonial approaches such as Mbembe's and the necropolitan notions than the previous or more traditional approaches that made a well-known comparison between criminals and the former internal enemy from the Cold War period. We think they belong to a category of people that are aimed and started aimed before the Cold War, during the Cold War, and after the Cold War. And they are more connected to our past of slavery and enormous inequality than to a specific period of repression represented by the Cold War in Latin America, especially in Brazil and Peru. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now going to have our second presentation. So in the program, there is an error. The name is Mahamadou Sabadogo, the other way around. And the title of the presentation is The Gap Between the Modern State and the Kinabe Society, an analysis of center periphery violence. Mohamed Sabadagu is an associate of the Crossroads of Study and Research Action for Democracy and Development. His research interests include violent extremism and radicalization in the Sahel. So the presentation is going to be French. And then we're going to have a translation in between.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I apologize myself because I don't speak very well English. But I will try some time to speak in English. It will be fast like this. Et le titre de ma présentation, c'est plutôt, je dirais que ma présentation, c'est une étude portée sur les facteurs de radicalisation au Sahel en général. Mais là, nous avons mis l'accent sur la relation qu'il y a entre le centre et la périphérie dans la lutte contre l'extrémisme violent.
My presentation is based on a case study that aims to analyze the violence between the periphery and the central.
Le Burkina Faso est un pays qui est situé au centre de l'Afrique de l'Ouest.
Burkina Faso is located at the center of the Western Africa.
Et jusqu'en 2015-2016, le Burkina Faso était épargné par l'extrémisme violent, par les groupes terroristes.
And since 2015-2016, Burkina Faso have lived under the threat of Malian terrorist group.
Mais suite à l'avènement de l'insurrection populaire qu'a connu le Burkina, et nous avons remarqué que le Burkina a commencé à basculer dans l'extrémisme violent après la chute du président Blaise Compaoré.
So after the
insurrection.
No, there was an insurrection, popular insurrection after the. When
after the election, the old president leave. He was been president since 27 years after Thomas Sankara.
So Compaoré was president for 27 years after Thomas Sankara, and then when he left the power, then there was popular insurrections.
La question qu'on s'est posée, c'est de savoir comment ces groupes ont pu s'enraciner dans un contexte sociopolitique tel que le Burkina.
So the question that we've asked to ourselves is that how did groups succeed to develop in a context like, in the Burkinabe context?
Il y a eu beaucoup d'études qui se sont appesanties sur la question, mais ils se sont focalisés sur les facteurs sociaux, culturels et les facteurs politiques.
A lot of studies have tried to answer the question, but they have been more focused on social political questions and
oui, économiques, sociopolitiques.
Yeah, they have been trying to answer those questions use sociopolitical factors.
Mais nous avons focalisé notre recherche sur la manière, c'est-à-dire la réponse de l'État à cette violence.
But our study is focused on the state's response towards that violence.
Et pendant nos recherches, qui ont duré près de et qui continuent d'ailleurs sur 3 ans, et nos entretiens nous ont permis de savoir que l'État même générait cette violence.
So we've carried researches and they're still ongoing for 3 years. And then what we have discovered is that the state is one of the main players into the production of that violence.
Et on a remarqué au fil de notre étude que l'acteur même principal, c'est-à-dire l'acteur qui permet le basculement de certaines populations, de certaines régions, c'est l'État.
So what we have noticed is that the state is, in some circumstances, the main factor that leads to popular insurrections.
Et donc on a remarqué qu'il y a une fracture entre d'abord la disparition de l'État au service de la nation et aussi une fracture, une grave crise de gouvernance entre le centre et la périphérie.
So what we have noticed is that there have been a separation between the central government and those one who lives in the peripheral areas.
Cette absence et cette génération de la violence est à l'origine même de la négation et du rejet du centre par la périphérie.
So the absence of the state is one of the main the tapping factor of the peripheral insurrection.
Extremism violence.
Sorry?
Of extremism violence.
Yeah, extremist violence. Yeah.
Et là nous avons la carte. Ça c'est la. Nous avons là la carte du Burkina Faso. Et les points que vous remarquez, c'est les différents zones que les groupes terroristes ont commencé à attaquer de 2016 à 2018. Donc vous voyez que la concentration se situe dans les périphéries, c'est-à-dire dans la région du nord qui est frontalière. Là nous avons le Mali, là c'est le Niger et là Bénin, Togo, Ghana.
So we can see that the concentration of those exertions are concentrated at the peripheral area, which are located more at the north of the country. And some other activities are happening in the south part of the country.
Au départ, la violence était vraiment exogène, c'est-à-dire les groupes venaient du Mali. Mais après, on a cherché à comprendre pourquoi la violence s'est endogénisée, c'est-à-dire pourquoi la violence est devenue interne.
So at the beginning, the terrorist actions were more located at the northern part of the country. They were coming from Mali. And then what we have noticed is that those violence have been migrating from the north to the south of the country. So we are trying to understand why those violent migrations.
Là nous avons la carte de la région du Sahel et la région de l'Est au Burkina Faso.
So there we have the map of the Sahel region and the other map is from the eastern part of Burkina.
Et les zones en noir, ce sont les zones où l'État a perdu le contrôle. Ce sont les zones contrôlées par les groupes extrémistes.
So the regions which are colored in black are those under the control of the terrorists.
Et les zones en rouge, ce sont les zones où l'administration a presque disparu. C'est-à-dire, il n'y a que quelques signes de l'État qui restent.
So, the zones who are colored in red are those who are still experiencing low profile of state government.
Et les zones en orange, ici, c'est les zones où l'État est plus ou moins continue toujours à avoir le contrôle.
So, the zones who are colored in green are those who are still experiencing the control of the central state.
Donc, on voit clairement que la violence part de des zones rurales, c'est-à-dire des zones externes, vers les zones urbaines.
So what we have seen is like violence is migrating from rural region to urban regions.
Maintenant, pourquoi cette violence passe des zones rurales aux zones, des zones rurales aux zones urbaines? Cela est dû à plusieurs facteurs.
So we have asked ourselves why are these violence migrating from rural to urban region, and then we think that there are a lot of factors.
Dans l'un des facteurs les plus essentiels, c'est que l'absence même de l'État a permis le développement des idéologies racistes, des idéologies plutôt radicales et extrémistes dans ces zones.
So one of the factors is like the state monopoly like has allowed for the development of those kind of exaction from rural to urban areas.
Et a fait prospérer un certain nombre de phénomènes, dont les groupes terroristes, les groupes d'autodéfense et bien d'autres phénomènes.
So the state, the absence of the state has given place, has allowed the development of terrorist groups, terrorists and self-defense group and other violence group that we have noticed in the country.
Et la progression de cette violence a été tellement fulgurante d'année en année, et nous allons voir avec les cas comment et cette violence a progressé très rapidement et a échappé à l'État.
So we, what we try to present is like how those terrorist groups have been developing from year to year and how they came to escape to the state control.
En 2016, on était à 5 provinces touchées et 37 incidents par an.
In 2016, we had 35 provinces which were under the control of those terrorists, and how many incidents?
Incidents, 37
incidents per year.
En 2017, on est passé à 12 provinces touchées et 94 incidents par an. So les points en rouge, c'est les zones où il y a eu les attaques terroristes, où il y a plus de violence.
So in 2017, we have moved from 5 to 12 provinces which have been attacked, and 94 provinces which were now under control of those terrorist group, and then we can see how they have been migrating from the north to the south part of the country.
Donc si vous voulez, à peu près le nombre a été multiplié par 3 à peu près.
So we can see that the number of the provinces which have been under the control of the terrorist group have been multiplied by 3.
En 2018, on est passé de 12 provinces à 16 provinces avec 310 incidents par an.
So in 2018, we have moved from 12 to 18 provinces, and then the incidences have grown from 94 to 110 incidences like per year.
Voilà où nous en sommes en 2019.
And here's where we are in 2019.
Pour dire que la situation ne fait que se démultiplier. Maintenant, qu'est-ce qui explique le fait que cette situation ne fait que s'accélérer, le fait que la violence est en train de se propager? Et si vous regardez bien, on voit que ça se propage des zones rurales vers, ça c'est Ouagadougou, c'est la capitale et au centre.
Yeah.
Donc ça se propage des zones rurales vers le centre.
So this is the situation that we have in 2019, and what the map can show us is like the situation is like going from worse to worse, and then it's migrating from north to south, and then it's almost reaching the capital city, which is at the center of the country.
Et ce que aussi on a remarqué, c'est que les zones où l'État a dit apporter une réponse, c'est les zones qui ont le plus basculé dans la violence.
And what has been noticed is like those regions where the state has pretended to bring solution are those parts of the country which has escalated in violence.
Donc, on a donc compris que l'État générait de la violence, et c'est cette violence qui faisait basculer un certain nombre de régions, un certain nombre de populations dans l'extrémisme violent.
So what we have understood is like it's the state that produces those kind of violence, and it, because of that, the role played by the state, that some other provinces are now tempted to join the extremist violence.
Et l'un des phénomènes que cette réponse a apporté pour le Burkina Faso, c'est la répartition du Burkina en plusieurs groupes de défense, c'est-à-dire les groupes d'autodéfense se sont répartis le pays.
So, as a consequence, what has been noticed is like the auto-defense group have not now like divided the country in different parts that they try to defend by their own.
Parce que l'État, dans sa réponse, a perdu le monopole de la violence physique légitime.
Because the state could not give the appropriate answer to the violences.
And en perdant le monopole de la violence physique légitime, et ce monopole est désormais partagé entre l'État et ses groupes d'autodéfense.
So the state has lost the monopoly of the legitimate violence, and because of that, the state is now trying to share like that monopoly of violence between him and the autodéfense groups.
Donc maintenant au nord, on a les groupes terroristes et des groupes d'autodéfense. Peu.
So at north part of the country, we have the terrorist group and the auto-defense group from the Peul population.
Fulani.
They are called Fulani.
Au centre et à l'est, on a des groupes d'autodéfense d'ethnie Mossi et Gourmaché qu'on appelle les Korloewo. Ça va être difficile à prononcer.
So at the center and east part of the country, you have this auto-defense group, which are Mossi and Korloewo.
No, his name is Korloewo.
Okay.
Korloewo, Kaka, if you want.
Okay.
And in the west, we have Dozos.
Okay.
And we have small group here. He's not far from Mali, and he's linked with Mali group. We call it Dala Amasugu. And you can notice that in the center, the part who belong to the state, the government is this part.
So, yeah.
You can notice that the state began to disappear. We call it like this because he don't get any more influence and the control in the country. What we can notice that the auto-defense group is a state in the state because they have right to arrest someone, to put it in jail, to take money to him, to kill him, and government doesn't say nothing. Even police or military want to catch this group auto-defense, they refuse. They have guns, knives, and baton, how do you call that?
Sticks.
But what we remark, this group refuse to fight against terrorist group. But they told people that they have here to defend people's interest against insecurity. But they think that terrorist groups are more strong than them. Then they cannot fight against terrorist group, but they can fight against criminal. And what is strange that state government use this group for election. They make a deal. And now government cannot dissolve this group, but they become strong and strong. And we can, which mean that this deal is that government give the power to this group to make security in his place. This is not normal in a democratic country. Donc, cela a eu pour conséquence de créer un certain nombre de groupes que j'ai expliqué. These consequences are make happen many groups. And this group, we have criminal auto-defense, and now we have terrorist group. But what we notice is all of these groups make a connection and ever not fight together against state, against government. In some region, they make they are linked between a population, criminal, terrorist group against a government. Because all of these groups are interests of government leave certain region because of resources, because of government presence. It means that it's violence, it's comment on appelle, la mal gouvernance.
The bad governance.
Yeah, the bad government, spoliation and corruption. And the consequence is in the central north of Burkina Faso, we have a three kind of groups. In these three kind of group, we have a group of criminal trafficking who want a state to leave, and they can continue to make traffic. We have the population who want state to leave because of when the government is present, the government is present by violence. The government is present by corruption. Is not here to defend the interest of our population. And the third group is the terrorist group who want to make a new state. They want to make a state like to do a Sharia in this region. And all these groups are linked together and fight again now a government. And is why in this case we can find that these are groups now take a power and power in all the rural region and control many regions, control more and more the land. Je vais avancer rapidement. Okay. This is a statistic who show that violence against civilians. We can find that in this map, civilian death in 2019 are so far far than 2018. And causality in the Sahel region in 2016 and 2019 are close to four than combined total in all over region. Death attributed to state force 2016 and 2019 more than two votes who committed by communal militants and jihadist group. Fatality by yeah, we can so easily in this map. We have 1,049 civilian causality registered in 2.5 years, more than double death toll of state and non-state combatants during this time period. In this year, we get 800 civilian death registered in the first half of 2019. Is the triple more than 2017 and 2018. And here you can see the violence and displacement. In the area, we get a variance, population, migration to another area. And we get between January 2018 and May 2019, violence even have increased six-fold the number of internally displaced persons, 20-fold. Violence even and IDPs have been highly concentrated in the north, especially in the Sum province. Show the violence displacement and the IDP displacement per year. And you notice that the displacement going to the north to the center. Et donc, en conclusion, on dira que tous ces événements ont eu pour conséquence de créer des insurrections armées locales dans la région du nord, du centre-nord et dans la région du Sahel au Burkina Faso.
So as a conclusion, you can say that all these events has as consequences the creation of insurrectional armed force within the north, the center and the south parts of the country.
Et donc aussi que la réponse apportée par l'État est une des causes de basculement des populations dans l'extrémisme violent. So,
another important point is like the state's response to this violence is one of the key elements of the exertion, the terrorist exertion within the country.
Ok, merci. C'était pas facile.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for introducing me. I'd like to take this opportunity also to thank Carl and Gap for inviting me to this colloquium as well. My presentation, you know, is titled On Violent Pentecostal Modernities. Of course, this is based on research that I conducted in Lagos, and also some of it in Johannesburg and partly in Pretoria. So I'll be making references to those cities, although for the most part you will realize that a lot of my examples are going to come from Lagos. They've spent a lot of time in Lagos in the past 2.5 years.
Where is Lagos?
Okay. Lagos is the commercial capital of Nigeria. All right. So here, I want to start off by mapping out, some conceptual ideas that I'm trying to develop here. Of course, this is a work in progress. I'm still just beginning to think through these ideas, especially when I was invited, of course, to tackle the concept, the issue of violence, based on my research on Pentecostalism. Right. So I am going to be working through this concept, which is my proposition, of course, the concept of Pentecostal theocraft, which is about how Pentecostalism, generates specific practices, a specific act of being in the world, and of engaging the world And in this particular case, of course, also under very difficult urban, you know, harsh urban environments, as you are going to see very soon. And of course, to develop this idea of Pentecostal theocraft, you know, I am fascinated by what I am referring here to is Pentecostal militarism. Of course, you know, this is reflected in the practices and of course in the language deployed by, you know, Pentecostal adherents and of course Pentecostal leaders, which is very, very militaristic, appropriating the language of warfare, you know, violent language, in fact, you know, in you know, confronting some of the challenges, you know, faced by the followership. And the idea of spatial aggression, here I'm looking at Pentecostal church institutions as actors, you know, in the city who have been, especially in a city like Lagos, appropriating space in the physical sense very, very aggressively. I will demonstrate that, you know, very soon. And of course, all of this, you know, Pentecostal militarism, you know, this spatial aggression of Pentecostal churches is justified by what has been referred to as dominion theology, where Pentecostalism is here to take over. If it is the city, it is there to take over the city. In many ways, it is there to convert. You know, there's a lot of emphasis on conversion, you know, of people, but also of places and spaces, and so forth and so forth. It's a very expansionist religion in that sense. So that is very, very important. It is part of you know, this Pentecostal practices, you know, the Pentecostal art of being in the world. Right. What I would want to propose is that when you look at Pentecostal institutions in the mold of Pentecostal churches, you will realize that these institutions, arguably, if I have to follow the Bodhisian argument, have become central banks, in this particular case, of the capital of physical force, capital of violence, but of course also of other capitals. You know, these are concentration, you know, of money, finance, concentrations of power, in various forms of those capitals that we know from Boju. And in this regard, there is an inevitable relationship with the state, which, of course, if you read Boju, you know, his understanding of the state is that the state is the central bank of capital, of course, of various forms of capital as well, including the capital of physical force. So what happens is in contexts where, you know, probably, you know, we have weakening states or weak states, you know, or even neglectful states, and I argue, you know, that when you visit Lagos, you realize that in many ways, the state probably is projected as weak, you know, in particular spaces of the city. And I think as a result, it is not surprising that we've seen a proliferation of Pentecostal churches. And they are occupying a particular space, some of which should have been occupied by the state, even in providing services, you know, from education to health, and so forth and so forth. So that's very, very important, you know, to note here. And of course, you know, even when you look at the Pentecostal church institution as a concentration of capital, you know, of the various species of capital, and in this particular case, the capital of physical force, but also the political capital, it is important to note that you know, these Pentecostal churches are very much connected to the state. They do not operate in isolation from the state. In fact, they've got a lot of influence politically, to the extent that you know, Nigerian scholar Ebenezer Obadare argued that you know, especially during the time of Obasanjo, what we had in Nigeria was a Pentecostal president. So if you are planning to be in politics in Nigeria, you've got to be good books with some of these Pentecostal pastor prophets, especially the big ones, you know, as it were. Otherwise, you will struggle. So in that regard, it's very clear that Pentecostal churches actually, you know, are concentrations of species of capital. I want to now refer to the capital of physical force and how it is manifesting itself, you know, in the spatial landscape of a city such as Johannesburg, as well such as Lagos. I'll focus on Lagos for now. When you look at the landscape of Lagos, it is not surprising that as you drive through, you are greeted by Pentecostal architectural edifices, huge, you know, mega buildings, you know, built by Pentecostal churches. This is an example of one of them, you know, a building that was commissioned, you know, in 2017, April. This is a church auditorium of the Deeper Life Christian Ministries. I'm just going to refer to it as Deeper Life, which was founded by Pastor William Kumuyi. This is maybe probably the fourth largest church in Nigeria. Right, so this is headquartered in a place called Bagada in Lagos. What is interesting about this building is that it can accommodate 33,000 adults in this church auditorium at a go, and 10,000 children, you know, in the basement. So basically, we can have 40,000 people congregated on a Sunday. And what that does to the neighborhood, you know, is unimaginable in terms of traffic jams and all sorts of problems. But I want to refer to a story around the process of building this particular edifice. That within the community, the information was not relayed that such a big church was going to be built. As a result, there were protests from the community. They were surprised to see this edifice just rising from the ground without any consultation. So there were a lot of protests. I spoke to the chairman of the Community Development Association, Mr. Eniyahu, during that time when I was doing research in 2018. And he says, well, this is an edifice that actually came as a surprise. And it triggered a series of community protests. You know, people asking the church to actually do something special about the road networks and so forth. There were big fights there. And you know, even the governor of the city, you know, at that time, Ambode, you know, to intervene, you know, to resolve this problem. And the church promised to open up new roads around the neighborhood and so forth. So, but this is not the only one. There are several of these Pentecostal edifices that have imposed themselves on the landscape, sometimes without consent from the residents. Just another story there around this expansion in terms of real estate. There, what you see is a church actually, you know, a building owned by Bishop Akerele, who is located, is almost like a circle surrounded by this, by the Deeper Life Church, because he refused to move when Deeper Life was buying out people from the neighborhood in order to build this church. He said, when you do your plan, do you also plan to buy my house? So he refused to move. So now his building is now, you know, almost like the car park of the church. And he also is running a church of his own. He's the bishop. It's called Jehovah Salvation Evangelical Church. Yeah. So this is a very interesting story, because I wonder if Bishop Akirele now wants to sell the house, given the promotion now, you know, around his own building, whether this will have any value, you know, because I don't think anybody will buy this particular property now. So there is a lot of aggressive spatial expansion, you know, some of which has no consent from the community. Even with this Deeper Life Church, you know, when I spoke to Mr. Eniyahu, the chairperson of the Community Development Association, he says that, you know, when they were building, they actually redirected the canal. You can see there's a lot of flooding now around the neighborhood, because you know, this church was built more like on top of a canal. So they had to redirect this canal, and there has been a serious environmental damage there, as you can see, you know, flooding around the area and so forth. And also, this is now the example of another church in Onikeya by Lagos. It's called the Mountain of Fire and Miracles Ministries International. This church has expanded quite vigorously over the years, and it has been buying out people as well, forcefully. And sometimes they offer you an amount that you cannot resist. If you refuse to move, then you have to endure the noise coming from the church, which is very, very, you know, consistent almost every Sunday, and of course midweek programs are so many. So what I, you know, this church uses paper as its color. And when you go to this area where the headquarters is, in Onikeyaba, you realize that the neighborhood is basically being painted purple. So I'm calling it here, the MFM painting the neighborhood purple. They are very aggressive. And of course, the MFM, to maintain order in this area, they work with area boys. The area boys are the gangsters that you find in Nigerian metropolises, and particularly in Lagos. The area boys, these are very dangerous, and so the church actually pays them, especially to control traffic and maintain order when they're having their church services. And it is interesting to note that the police are also very present in these places. In fact, if you go to MFM, you realize that there is always a police van There's actually a police station in the church. Because each time there's an event, they need the police on standby. In case somebody does something, at least the police have the power to arrest. Okay. Just an example again of this Pentecostal speciality, aggressive Pentecostal expansion in the special sense. If you go to just outside Lagos to a place called Magoro in Ogun State, 24 kilometers from Lagos, along the Lagos Ibadan Expressway, you find that there are a series of cities built by these churches. This one is Prayer City, built by the MFM. People are buying into this place to live there. But the land belongs to the church. What you own is the bricks on your house. So it's like if usufructuary life in the church. Their prayer takes place 24/7. The pastors are having shifts every 3 hours, you know. They pray 24/7 for all the problems of the world, and so forth and so forth. So I'll talk about prayer very soon, the work that it does. This is just inside the prayer city. What they call deliverance grounds. There, because there's a particular theology that informs this development. The belief is that we are in a war, you know, as it were, and that war demands that we pray, that we engage in forms of deliverance, you know, to free people from oppression. So the argument, as it goes, is that sometimes this militaristic forms of Pentecostalism that have emerged in our cities, particularly here in Lagos, are also in many ways informed by the environment in which these Pentecostal churches have emerged. These African Pentecostal churches have emerged. These are environments which are very harsh, environments of limited means. You see here, this is the old headquarters of a church called the Redeemed Christian of God. I think this is the biggest church in Nigeria, Pentecostal church, which was located in the Putten Meta. This is a slum. You can see the environment, it's a very, very difficult environment. It's not surprising that as a result of these harsh environments, this world of limited means, these churches end up actually, reproducing militarized Pentecostal habitus. Right, and I have to move on to the concept of Pentecostal militarism and the idea of spiritual warfare. Right, if you go to the Mountain of Fire Church, the language used there is very, very militaristic. They speak about evil arrows. When I went there the other time when I was praying for, I was made to repeat a particular prayer point. That evil arrows from the belly of my family idol must die. So there's this militaristic language. And of course it reflects the environment in which these churches have emerged. And of course the language is back to center. Things should backfire. Those missiles from your enemies should backfire to those enemies. And the language of death is very key. When you attend these churches, there is this word that you hear, especially MFM. The word "ku ku ku" is the Yoruba for die, die, die. So if you are praying, you should keep on saying die, 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 die. I will show you a 30-second clip of a prayer that I attended. And then, if you come to South Africa, of course, there's a church that I've been looking at for the past 2 years as well. But this is in Pretoria. Every Friday there is a session called War Room. When you go there, people will be jumping and fighting in the air. That's how we should pray. And of course, the founder of the church is a prophetess with the title Field Marshal. So this is actually very militaristic in orientation. Right, so, and there's another church that I started, Local Victory Ministries, just here. I remember the other time there was a program called Farmers Die. So we'll be praying for those enemies of yours to die, in the physical sense, of course, not just to die spiritually. At some point, the church, this pastor was saying, there's a guy whose anger was troubling me, maybe through witchcraft. And he said, I saw him in the dream and I killed him in the dream. And of course the guy came to give a testimony. He said, my anger is already dead as we speak, is in the motion. So that's the language that is used. This is some kind of spiritual level politics, the politics of death driven Pentecostal. And of course the Pentecostal pastor prophets are considered themselves to be spiritual fathers, but in other words, they also are spiritual police. To protect their members, their followers in that regard. The MFM, just for you to think in terms of Pentecostal citizenship, and the production of Pentecostal circles, prayer is quite a very important key practice there. Because prayer is a practice of appropriation, a practice of appropriation of Pentecostal citizenship. In other words, Pentecostal theocraft. It's a means of warfare, a technique of liberation. I bought this book, it's in my book, in my session now, but I can't take it out, it's far. And it's called The Prayer Passage. If you are a member of MFM, you read this one. Because it's very necessary for you to be able to crush oppression, you know, as it will. I'm coming to the end. And of course, the idea of born-againness, you know, is very key to Pentecostalism. And of course, you know, born-againness is about claiming a particular citizenship, you know, within the field of Pentecostalism, within, in the context of Pentecostal theocraft. So, born-againness entails the politics of inclusion and exclusion. One day I wanted to get into a guest house in Lagos. You know, these churches run guest houses at the MFM. I was asked the question, are you born again? Before I book into the guest house, I don't tell you what the answer was. But they told me, if you are a Muslim, you are not welcome here. If you are this African traditional religion, you are not welcome here. So there's a politics of inclusion and exclusion, you know, that is driven by these Pentecostal churches. Let me just show you this deliverance session where they pray and die, die, die. Okay, so I attended this one. And I was also delivered, I think, because I went through the whole process. I can tell you, going to the gym is much lighter than this process. You'll be so tired at the end. I lost my voice. I went to sleep for almost 15 hours after undergoing the delivery process. It's so violent. You have to be jumping and shouting at the top of your voice. So. And again, prayer itself is a form of martial arts. This is from a Pretoria church, this Citizens of Heaven church. Let me just show you the clip and then I will end my presentation. So I'll end there. There's no conclusion. This is work in progress. And to pay, that's thank you in Yoruba. And it's been fantastic.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Sam.
Thanks very much. Always. And the other two presenters. So the time has come for questions, and obviously when the three presentations came in, overlap. Because when you listen to the first presentation, it's about how the favelas are the colonies. Colonies under military intervention, colonies under like gang leaders, and militias. And then when you go to Burkina Faso, it's more like around the weak state. And how violence begins on the periphery and slowly it moves at the center. And slowly you can see how the state is sort of like disappearing. And of course, I mean, the last presentation was quite moving. And especially in terms of the Pentecostal militarism and the language that gets used. And I guess many of you can relate with how the state and churches sort of like collude in certain sort of practices. But the floor is yours. I'm going to take like about 3 to 4 hands. Okay, Alice. Okay, I'll take 5. Sorry, Tia, Alice.
Thanks for the presentations. They were all interesting. And my first question is based on the Brazil presentation. I wanted to know if the Marines that we have seen, are they from the USA or from the Brazil? And if they are from the USA, does it mean that the Brazilian local state has resigned for American power to come and be implemented and try to enforce order in Brazil? And this second point maybe is from the presentation for Burkina. Like, it seems like the population, I mean, we are used to see violence as response to violence. So now what has been seen is like violence has been response to the lack of the violence from the state, a violence which seems to be accepted and needed by the governed population. So how can you conceptualize the resignation of the state? Can the state's absence in government be seen as another form of violence? And the last question is for Obvious. I know you said that you're still like going through the analysis, but what we've seen is like this, the churches, Pentecostal churches, are somehow taking the role, some of the role which are supposed to be played by the state. So the way those churches are developing, does it give a place for a resistance, like the resistance of the states, of the church symbolic violence? Do we have a space for that?
Thank you. Please request that we keep our question brief.
Okay. Good morning. Okay, again. My question would be directed to the last speaker, Mr. Obvious. Yes, thank you so much for your wonderful research. We can see really what's happening here within the church community. Definitely we can see here, this is why perhaps even in South Africa, there's a discussion, there's a debate from the state that they want to regulate the churches, they want to do some what they call lifestyle audit. Mainly because it looks like some of these churches know they are just there for cash, not money. So my question for to you is that, given with your research, don't you see perhaps a danger from these churches? Because to me, some of them are just cults. If you recall back somewhere back 1979, you remember there was a reverend somewhere in America called Jimmy Jones. He was very, very influential. He had a huge following. But what was the end result? At one stage, he said to his followers, oh, the Almighty has called me. Let's just all drink poison and let's go to heaven. Something like about 1,000 people died. So during your research, don't you foresee perhaps that kind of danger happening within maybe South Africa or Nigeria? Where? Thank you.
Thanks. A very interesting kind of series of presentations, and as Melusi said, with quite intriguing sort of echoes and reverberations across them. So I've got a particular question, I think, to the Brazilian case, to the favela case, and then maybe a question that cuts across all of them. So for the favela, I mean, for Tiago and Jed, the question is really, first the comment. I mean, I find really interesting the reference right back to Roman martial law. I mean, I think that gives us a really long history and a really long relation to conquest and colonialism, you know, to think through. But the emphasis in your presentation was very much on the violent moment, the gunshots and so on, the Marines, and the Marines also feeling under siege. I mean, the gunfire that they're receiving, in a sense, was very interesting. But what I'm curious about is the other elements in your proposal, which is around governmentality, which is not to do with direct violence, I mean, conceptually anyway. And how that works in the favelas, because it seems to me that, you know, most of the time they are not occupied by the Marines or the military. There's a different kind of order that prevails. And you lump together all of the armed actors, you know, the gangs and so on, but there seems to be a way in which a certain kind of military intervention is aimed directly against the gangs, whereas on a day-to-day level there's a police collaboration with the gangs. So I'm interested in you unpacking this kind of complexity. But that leads to the resonance across the three cases is that in all three cases we're talking about counter forces, forces outside of the state, zones that are governed through different means than the direct means of I don't know what to call it anymore, you know, the normal state, let's, you know, put that in quite marks. In very interesting ways, across urban zones and far rural zones. And at first glance, they all look like zones resistant to state authority. But you've all alluded to ways in which there's also collusion and interpenetration of the central states and the kinds of authorities that emerge in those zones. And I wonder if you can just comment, because like your presentations may have emphasized one or the other point. So if I come to Mahamudu, your presentation, you know, it looks like the central state is shrinking, it's becoming less and less, and then these zones where other authorities exist. But at the same time, you talk about the central government using the armed, the self-defense units in part of elections. So I wonder if you can maybe reflect on the degree to which this is. These are zones in which have pushed the state back, and the extent to which they are actually zones in which the government is ruling, or the state is ruling, by other means. And all of this question, of course, takes us back to Desmond Arias's concept of violence, pluralism, and hybridity, the hybridity of governance. So I wonder if you could just reflect, you know, very briefly on those points.
Thank you all to the presenters. Very, very fascinating conversation. So I have two questions, one for Thiago, kind of similar to this question now. So you make reference to the colony, and I guess I was hoping you can maybe speak a little more specifically about the types of security and policing that took place in the Brazilian colony, because it played out very differently in different colonies. There were very different systems. So I would like to know just what were the forms, informal or formal, types of policing that emerged in the Brazilian colony, and whether you see the connection between those forms and what you're pointing to happening today in the favelas. And for obvious, I really, really love your presentation. I think it's such an important conversation to be having, especially this day and age. I worked on a paper with a gender scholar on men who are transitioning out of gangs via the church. And one thing that was interesting that really came up was the role of masculinities and the sort of way in which the evangelism plays into a certain type of masculinity. So when you think about the Pentecostal militarism, can you maybe speak about the gendered element of that? And sort of like, you know, the kind of patriarchal or gender roles and gender performances that are central to the way in which the militarism is taking shape. Thank you.
Okay. everybody. I'm Kudwala Jethro, independent writer and commentator. To me, these churches, I think, they're just a money-making scheme. I think they are Illuminati churches, charismatic churches. Talk about churches which make people to drink liquor inside the church, eat snake, etc. So, Katsawara, you agree or disagree with me? Thank you, bye.
Thank you for the questions. Let me see here. Alice, oh, is this well, the Marines were all Brazilian. Okay. In fact, your question is very interesting because Brazil in Latin America is one of the countries, perhaps, maybe the main country that has resisted to the temptation or oppressions from the United States to militarize their public security questions or the war on drugs until now. So since the 80s, Mexico, Colombia, Peru, Bolivia, etc., in Central America as well, they have passed through this question, through this militarization or disengagement, deployment of the military to fight gangs and to fight drug trafficking. In Brazil, it's not true, and right now we're passing through some changing. And it's not just the same as you can find in Mexico, for example. It's an over-experience in Mexico. It's completely different, it's deeper, but you can find something in that direction. But it's all, they are Brazilians, they have American equipment, some money from the United States, but it's mainly a Brazilian direction and Brazilian strategy. Let me see. Carl, thanks a lot for your question. In fact, it is most, I think that it is the most important part of our reflection, is how to broaden the discussion on govern. And using this the concept, the Foucauldian concept of governmentality and biopolitics, for example, or the Mbembe's criticism on this issue, and it's not just criticism, but this complement, this addition, or this development on, from this the Foucauldian notions of biopolitics, I think it's crucial to understand what is happening in Brazil, because in these slums and townships, we have this connection. I mentioned very quickly that this connection is not just a connection of violence and enforcement in a more explicit way. It is a combination between it's a very biopolitical combination between force and a lot of other positive actions, to use a Foucauldian term, for the exercise of power. So that's why I mentioned the church, that's why I mentioned the NGOs, foundations from Brazilian and foreign enterprises, companies, private companies, the relationship with local leaderships, including some leaderships that started working during the dictatorship as leaderships from the local resistance against the leadership, against the dictatorship. The first they were related to the beginning of the civil rights movement in Brazil, for example, and now they are connected to this kind of hybrid government, this governmentality that connects the legal system and the illegal system, the legal economy and the illegal economy, the official or the official city and the non-official city, and they are all connected. I use this inside-outside metaphor, but they are not separate environments. They are all connected. So that's why I like the metaphor of being hybrid, but I prefer the symbiotic idea of connection, because the legal city depends on the legal city as well, the legal economy depends on the legal economy, they are very well connected. So I cannot understand, I cannot imagine the operational or a functional city in Rio de Janeiro without this connection. It's the way it works. So it's not a dysfunctional city. It works like that. That's why I like the Arias and Goldstein idea of violent pluralism, because it's not an anomaly. It could be complicated, bad, violent, but it is the way things work. And finally, Javier, in fact, your question, and yesterday I enjoyed a lot your presentation, because it made me think precisely about your question right now. You mentioned and talk about a little bit about the commandos here. And especially during the 19th century in Brazil, the monarchy in Brazil, Brazil was a monarchy during the 19th century. The monarchy created a special kind of law enforcement agency called the National Guard. The National Guard was more or less what the commandos were here. They were private groups led by landowners. Those landowners received a rank of colonel, and they operated in a parallel fashion with the state forces, armed forces, the army or the navy, and they were supposed to enforce the monarchy regime or the monarchy law in distant regions in Brazil, and also to preserve enslavement or slavery system, and to capture slaves, to fight the quilombos. Quilombos were the special communities created by slaves that could run away from their situation of enslavement. So it is quite, since as far as I know, the story of the commandos here, I see a lot of similitudes between the commandos and the Guarda Nacional. And this, just to sum up, the army in Brazil, after the so-called Triple Alliance of War, or the Paraguayan War against Paraguay that was took place between 1864 and 1870, the monarchy, this the second the king, the emperor Peter II, tried to deploy the army to hunt slaves, and the army didn't get it. And they, the main officials and generals and field marshals, etc., resisted to this kind of task, saying that the task wasn't noble enough for the military, and it was one of the main entrances for the Republican discourse in Brazil. And one of the influences that led the military and the army, especially, to lead a coup d'etat against Peter II and started putting an end to the monarchy and inaugurated the Republican regime in Brazil in 1889. So there is a connection between the republicanism in Brazil and slavery.
Thank you.
abolitionism, not against slavery.
Ok, merci. Cool. Pour la réponse à la question de Carl.
Regarding the answer to Carl's questions.
Effectivement, les terroristes et plutôt le gouvernement utilisent les groupes terroristes pendant les élections et aussi bien avant en préparation des élections.
But what we have noticed is like the states use those terrorist groups before the election and during the election. So before the election for the preparation of those elections and during the election.
Bien sûr, cela n'est pas officiel, mais dans l'attitude et dans la stratégie de réponse de l'État, on voit clairement que il y a une manière très subtile d'utiliser ces groupes terroristes.
So that the deal they have with the terrorist group is not official, but through the state's response, we see that there is this collaboration that is established between the state and the terrorist group.
On a le contrôle des sites miniers.
We have the control of mining sites.
L'État laisse les sites miniers sous le contrôle des groupes terroristes.
So the state has give up the control of the mining sites to the terrorist groups.
Qui exploitent ces mines.
And those terrorist groups do export those mines.
Et revendent les produits de les minerais à des bailleurs qui sont proches du pouvoir.
So the terrorist group do exploit those mining sites and then sell the raw product to the multinational who are next to the government.
Et ces bailleurs sont censés financer les campagnes de gouvernement.
And those funders are the ones who support the election, like ruled by the election prepared by the government.
Il y a aussi le fait que certains grands opérateurs économiques proches du gouvernement.
There is another fact that those huge economic actors who are close to the government
qui utilisent ces groupes terroristes pour faire pour protéger leurs produits de leurs produits trafiqués, c'est-à-dire les produits de contrebande.
So there are those huge economic actors who are close to the government who also have resorted to the terrorists protection during their transactions.
Il y a un rapport des Nations Unies qui a mis l'accent sur ça.
There is a United States report that has emphasized on those points.
Et qui a désigné des personnes influentes économiquement proches du pouvoir qui financent ces groupes terroristes là.
And they have there is a United Nation reports that has pointed out those huge economic power who do finance those elections using the terrorist money.
Et aussi pendant les campagnes électorales, l'État utilise les groupes terroristes pour avoir l'exclusivité d'accès à certaines zones.
So during the electoral campaign, the state do negotiate with terrorist actors so that they can have access to some zone which are under control of the terrorists.
Et cette exclusivité d'accès signifie que les partis d'opposition, les partis opposés au gouvernement, n'ont pas accès pour battre la campagne.
So it's the
exclusivity.
No, we have like the state, like the governing political party use those terrorists to have exclusive access to some parts of the country, and then the terrorists make sure that the opposition does not reach those other parts of the countries.
Et aussi dans la stratégie de réponse militaire, il y a le fait que le gouvernement met l'accent dans les zones où la rente électorale sont favorables. Donc, ou dans le bassin électoral plus élevé.
Even through the strategic military response, so the state makes sure that they have the monopoly of control within the sites where the terrorists have access, and but not the opposition.
Et on a l'exemple de la région de l'Est où il y a eu la première grande opération militaire qui a été qui a eu lieu en 2019.
So we have one of the examples is like the eastern part of the country that has experienced like huge military responses during
non pas les élections, c'est une opération qui a eu lieu en 2019.
Yeah, there was this huge military response in the eastern part of the country in 2019.
Et sur le plan stratégique militaire, cette opération n'avait pas sa raison d'être. Parce que les groupes terroristes n'ont pas leur bassin dans cette zone.
But what was kind of weird is like a military strategic plan, that action was not justified because the terrorist group do not operate in that part of the country.
Mais l'État a mis toutes ses forces dans cette zone parce que c'est une zone où l'électoral est sont acquis.
But the state has concentrated all its military strategy in that part of the country because it's a part within which they are sure to win the election.
Et a laissé la zone nord Sahel où les groupes terroristes maîtrisent, et alors que cette zone est sous le bassin électoral de l'opposition.
Yeah, so the state did not mind going to the northern Sahel region, which is occupied, which is in favor of the opposition, but occupied by the terrorists.
C'est comme si l'État faisait un deal tacite avec les groupes terroristes en leur disant, écoutez, nous on prend l'Est et puis on vous laisse le Sahel.
So it's as if the state has made a tacit deal with the terrorists, saying that we're gonna take the eastern part of the country and we leave to you the northern Sahel part of the country.
Et donc, ce qu'il faut retenir dans tout ça, c'est que l'État, sur le plan international, joue à la victime.
So what we can take from this is like at the international level, the state is playing the victim.
Alors qu'en réalité, et par sa réponse qu'il apporte, on voit clairement que l'État profite mieux ou bien profite de cette situation pour asseoir de plus belles ses assises et accéder au pouvoir.
Well, in reality, what we can notice is that the state is taking advantage of this situation to continue ruling under this form of states of violence.
Et donc, la communauté internationale continuera de fournir des armes, des munitions à l'État, de former son armée, et alors qu'en réalité, cette armée est au service soit d'une élite politique, et même ou même cette armée est au service ou elle fait des deals avec ses groupes armés.
So, given that the state is playing the victim at the international level, so what we have noticed is like the international community continues to finance the state so that the state can buy arms and other military equipment for the national army, like while the state is playing a double role, like making deal with these terrorist groups.
Okay. Pour la question de Alice, c'était de savoir la résiliation et la démission de l'État. Est-ce que c'est une forme de violence?
So my question was like, can we see like the state's the fact that the state has resignated, can it be seen as a form of violence?
Oui, effectivement, c'est une forme de violence parce que l'État ne joue pas l'absence que l'État réalise dans certaines zones encourage les groupes terroristes à s'installer, à prendre l'occupation de ces zones.
So, according to, we can say that the state resignation can be seen as a form of violence because when the state decides to abandon a part of its country, it is exposing its own population to other forms of violence under the rules of those terrorist groups.
Et surtout quand ils donnent main libre à des groupes d'autodéfense de réguler la société à sa place.
And especially when it gives the power to self-defense group to rule it on its behalf.
Okay, merci.
Thank you.
Obvious?
Yes. Thank you.
I'll start responding to Alice's question on whether there is resistance or not to the church's symbolic violence. Of course, there is resistance. If you look at the I talked about the Community Development Association in Baghdad and Lagos, you know, which almost was fighting with the church when that building was erected. There were a lot of protests. That also brought in you know, the governor of Lagos State, Amote, you know, into the picture. So that is, you know, it's always there. Even here in South Africa, you know, I remember in 2013 when I was doing research there, you know, there was a fight between the Community Policing Forum and a particular church, where the accusation was that the church was making a lot of noise in the neighborhood, children were not able to study, because the church went 24/7 almost, and throughout the night, and that was a major problem. And the pastor ended up threatening the CPF guys, telling them that I'll kill you if you take food from my table. Okay, so that's an example of you know, how there is resistance, you know, even contestation in that context. So the second question from Mr. Sbanda, we're talking about the regulation of the church's lifestyles, you know, the lifestyles of the pastors, and you know, sounding an alarm bell about danger. And sometimes these churches are just cults, you know, and so forth. Well, I mean, probably, you know, but it's much more complicated than that. And I'll tip that with the question on money-making schemes, isn't it? I just bring it together. You know, the dismissal that these churches are simply money-making schemes, it's not as simple as that. It's much more than that. That is my argument. Well, the money-making would be happening, but a lot of other things are also happening, right? And that is why we keep on having a lot of membership in these churches. It's not that they are stupid or that they are irrational. There's something going on there. As a sociologist, my task is to understand how people produce meaning. You know, all these processes of meaning making, you know, happening in these churches. Even some of the pastors, you know, like the field marshal in Pretoria, always says that there's original fake everywhere, isn't it? So that's the argument. There are also fake pastors, but there are also fake Christians, she says. So it's much more complicated than that. So I don't want to pass on a judgment, you know, but rather I stay in my lane as a sociologist and try to draw meanings to these practices, you know, happening in these churches. And I think if I do that, I will do my job better than when I simply dismiss these churches as money-making schemes or as cults or you know, and that kind of stuff. But car zones governed by other means, surely, I mean. It's very interesting. If you go to Lagos, for example, the prayer city I showed you is a gated community. You cannot enter there. It's a private city, in other words. You know, if you are to enter there, you have to go through some kind of vetting because there are security guards at the entrance who will tell you if you are wearing, if you are a man and you have an earring, you can't get in. If you are a lady and you are wearing pants, not dressed in a manner that they think is suitable for a lady, you cannot get in. With the situation with the female research assistant who was not allowed in, would go out and get a piece of cloth so that she covers herself for us to have access to that space. So that is very true. And of course, you know, zones governed by other means. I have sometimes explored you know, this through the notion of pastoral power, and it links to what you were saying about biopolitics and so forth. These are spaces, their own rules, and you know, the specific forms of what I call pastoral biopolitics. Even what I you know, learning from Foucault, I call pastoral psychology, the governance of the souls, and of the sides of human beings, you know, people who follow these particular churches. Mm-hmm. Right, so then there is the issue of masculinity and so forth. It's still, again, a very interesting question. Of course, there are various expressions of masculinity, even when the church is led by a woman, like in the case of the field marshal. The pastor prophet needs some muscle, you know, around it. You realize that there are strong bodyguards always accompanying the prophet or the pastor. They don't just walk without that muscle. I remember the other time with the church that is in the Joburg CBD that I showed you earlier on. The guy told me, I was preaching, I was saying, oh, we need spiritual security, but we also need physical security. The fact that I'm a pastor doesn't mean that I'm stupid. That's why I have this bodyguard. If you mess with me, they will break your legs. Okay, so so it shows you that there are various manifestations of masculinity and so forth that are very, very prominent in these churches. Even if you look at crime, talking about how churches provide an avenue for people to move out of gangs, which is very interesting because even those who don't move out of gangs remain are also in churches. If you look at Nigeria, when I did research, I didn't present that now. T.B. Joshua's church. I was told that a lot of the tithes that are paid are coming from guys engaged in criminal activity, particularly oil bankers in Nigeria. So they bring the money to the church with the hope that they can clean it up. Wow. Even the ritualists, those who are believed to make money clean occultic rituals, I'm told they still bring the money to the church with the hope, belief that they can clean it up. So it's much more complicated in that sense. Okay.
Yeah,
that's a good idea.
Thank you.
I don't know if...
Okay.
It's very, very brief.
Sure.
I'll keep my question to one man and one man only, because I didn't see that coming. Obvious. It was the presentation wasn't that obvious, actually. Yeah. Do you think, okay, first, I was under the impression that Nigeria is Islamic State, so it uses a Sharia law. I want you to explain that. Could this be a response to Islam? Okay, so that's the first question. Another question that's linked to that is, what's the correlation between these churches and the non-state actors such as Boko Haram? Do you think this could be Boko Haram will be responding in an Islamic way to this kind of behavior? Or what's your take on that? I just wanted to explain. Thank you.
Thanks.
Shido from the Conversation Africa. The first question is maybe even a comment to Sava Dogo. So you'd say Burkina Faso is basically a hate speech. I wonder if you agree with that. And obviously, you mentioned the hold that the churches have on politicians and that how difficult it is to become to govern without the endorsement of the churches. Would that explain why nothing has happened to T.B. Joshua since in 2015, when over 100 people died in this church, which was poorly built, and I don't know where that case is. And living in the media, we try to get nobody to write about it in Nigeria, so that's the whole extent to even the media in the country.
Colleagues?
I will also add something. I take a right in the gentleman's question on Islam to add the thing about the Yoruba traditions and how it's working there, the clash between this Pentecostal thing and the Nigeria Yoruba tradition. About this question about the churches, in the favelas. The first thing I believe in Foucauldian, also thinking in Foucauldian terms, is the role that the Pentecostal or neo-Pentecostal churches have in Brazil, particularly in the favelas, as a major power force in the production of subjectivities. The people are to prepare people to be functional or operable in the neoliberal economy and to behave following a set of rules that are very strict. There is a concept in Brazil to analyze from sociologists who are working with this and researching the Pentecostal phenomenon in Brazil, and they have created a special kind of theology that is called the prosperity, the theology of prosperity. It's a neoliberal version of religion as well. Like people need to adjust their behavior, not to resist to the changes in their economy, to the changes in their lifestyle, but instead they need to adjust to be feasible for this new kind of economy that Brazil is now inserted. So it is a form of government, it's a form of governmentality that don't use, the form that doesn't use direct violence, but it is a form to prepare those people for a specific kind of behavior. That's why I'm thinking, when I think about the role of churches as well, of course there is a relationship with the government, and some pastors have begun, the professional politicians as well, etc. It's, of course, there is an issue in a more institutional way. But I would stress this other face, the other face of this coin, that is the face of production of subjectivity in order to adjust for the neoliberal economy. Thanks for your question.
Yes. Well, Nigeria cannot be regarded as an Islamic state. We know that Islam is quite strong in Nigeria, and especially concentrated in northern Nigeria. It's one of the major religions, yes, but we cannot reduce Nigeria to just an Islamic state. Right, so that is just a clarification. The correlation between churches and non-state actors, that is Boko Haram. You're asking what kind of relationship?
In a sense, Boko Haram responds to this. In other words, you look at this discourse, you have two polars.
Yes.
You have the Christian polar as emanate from these churches, and then you have the Islamic polar emanating in the form of Boko Haram, kind of like contrasting each other.
Okay, Well, I mean, the relationship is very complicated, complex actually, because we know, I mean, a lot of the churches have securitized as a result of the fear of Boko Haram. Some churches, when you enter them, it's like you're entering an airport, Like the Christ Embassy headquarters in Ikeja. It's securitized, There are metal detectors everywhere. And all the churches, almost are doing that because of the fear of Boko Haram, that is very clear. But there's something that should not be missed, because when you look at Islam and Christianity, Pentecostalism and Islam, there are also interconnections which are quite positive in that people actually circulate between these religions. It does not mean that if somebody is a Muslim, they won't go to a Pentecostal church.
Oh, really?
Right? So, even when you look at mainland churches, such as the Catholic Church, a lot of people are moving from this church to that, because in terms of what they need, they go away, they think they'll get an answer. So that is the truth. Speaking to some Nigerian clergymen, that's what they explained to me. So there's circulation. Even when you look at that area that I referred to, where the prayer city is, very close to it, there's also a charismatic, there's an Islamic city there that has been built, which is It's called Nasrat, eh? Which is a form of charismatic Islam, which is in many ways trying to compete with Pentecostalism. So to survive, Islam needs to the charismatic Islam, you know. So there are these exchanges, that are happening between these two religions. So you cannot really say it's just fighting. And then the church and their order of politicians. Well, I don't think I have to answer that because Mario has already provided an answer of how powerful these Pentecostal pastor prophets are. In fact, some of them are advisors to the president and the politicians, even at a transnational scale. You know, T.B. Joshua was actually an advisor to John Atta Mills, the Ghanaian president. So if you look at that, you realize how influential these guys are. In fact, T.B. Joshua is almost untouchable because in terms of domestic tourism coming into Nigeria, SCOAR, this church is actually one of the dominant churches that is bringing foreigners into the country. And in fact, with that, millions of dollars are coming into Nigeria. So, there are complications there. Okay, anyway, I think that's it.
Yeah,
tomorrow
I will get it.
Donc, pour répondre à la question, je dirais que, en fait, ce n'est pas que l'État va disparaître au Burkina.
Regarding the question if the state will disappear in Burkina, Chin said that I don't think that it will disappear.
Mais c'est la forme de gouvernance, c'est la forme même de l'État qui risque de changer.
But what I see is like it's the form of the states that's going to change.
Parce que lorsqu'on regarde les phénomènes qui sont en train d'apparaître, on voit clairement que c'est cette forme de gouvernance, cette forme d'État qui est carrément remise en cause par l'ensemble de la société.
So when we analyze the things that are happening, it's like it's the traditional state form which is questioned by the society.
Et cette menace vient de différents acteurs. On a premièrement un des principaux acteurs qui est la chefferie traditionnelle.
And this threat comes from different actors, which among which we have like the traditional leaders.
Et il ne faut pas perdre de vue que cette chefferie traditionnelle a toujours voulu instaurer une sorte de monarchie constitutionnelle.
And we have to keep in mind that these traditional leaders have always wanted to establish a form of monarchy.
Et si cette forme d'État échoue, il y a de fortes chances que ils essayent de prendre le dessus sur l'État actuel.
So if the actual form of the state does fail, there are a lot of chances that these traditional leaders come to take the ownership of the state to establish the monarchy.
La deuxième probabilité, c'est le fait même que la société rejette carrément toute cette forme de gouvernance.
And the second probability is like the society is going to reject all these forms of governance.
Et là, je pense que il va falloir qu'on reconstruise carrément et cet État-nation là.
So as a consequence, we will be tempted, like the result will be like we have to reconstruct a new form of the state.
Et je pense que c'est probablement dans cette hypothèse qu'on est en train d'aller.
And it seems like we are going through that that way.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.